Hello everyone, welcome to my La MaMa sharing. So I was in La MaMa last summer, in July, the whole month. These are the people who were there. So basically, the La MaMa directors, International Symposium for Directors, for my year had two parts, they had two sessions, divided into 2 weeks and 2 weeks. And I've decided to go for all 4 weeks.
Hi Sharon, how are
you? In the 4 weeks there were every 1 week there will be two teaching artists. So I went for all four, so I had 8 teaching artists. I'm just gonna share with you. There are no words here, it's just pictures. So don't expect much. Where it is? It's in Umbrian, which is a state in Italy which has no coastline. It's the only state that has no coastline. So it's all hills and mountains, and it's really beautiful. So part of the program is we get to go out into the city. The nearest city is Orvieto. It was really beautiful just to be in the hills. And then we would eat together, have meals together, sometimes outside, sometimes inside. And we went to watch performances because they have this festival called the Spoleto Open. I happened to catch Robert Wilson there, I mean, of all people.
Wow.
It was that time when he had come to Singapore and then he did a talk, and then when I went there, I was like, oh my god, this is God sent. So I caught it with Elizabeth De Rosa and Danny Yeo, who were also the Singaporean participants. And we, in between weeks, we would go out and travel to other towns to do things. So this is in the later part where we here, it's in as all. So we went to a pottery making place. In our free time, we would just chat and talk with her. Yeah, and this is at the castle of fava. Fava beans, which is like rice, like barley. And we were invited to their castle, and they have people there. It's quite fun. Yeah, so I'll start with the first one, which is Marco Calvani and Neil Labute. Director playwright collaboration. So basically, this is Neil. He's from New York, and this is Marco from Italy. So this is the first exercise that we did, which was to identify what our strength as a playwright director is. So we were looking at a collection of photos, and we looked at which we resonated with. But every time we decided we liked this photo, they would ask us to switch with the person beside us. So it kind of like forced us to think outside of that photo. Yeah. Sorry, I think I hear people coming.
This is weird.
Okay, sorry. Just some random people. We work in groups. Before that, there was about... In the first 2 weeks, there was about 18 of us. Most of them were from US, and there was a few of us that were from Singapore. So, this is Joanna, this is Lydia, this is Henry, this is Eric. What was lovely about the first workshops was that Marco had his own youth group, which was mixed soul. So we had a chance to work with 5 very talented Italian actors who were bilingual. Yeah, it was apparently an experience that had never happened before in the symposium. It was the first time that there were actors that directors could work with. They were saying how usually directors would have to direct other directors who were participants in making a performance. So we were given a few open scripts to kind of devise and then play with. This was the most stressful because being Asian, being Muslim, because when I introduced myself as my latest work, which was Hantaran at that time. And so there was a bit of, like, people didn't know who I was and it was very guarded with me. So it took a while for them to warm up to what I had to share. And it culminated to the last three open scripts. We were three and we did presentation, and then this is the last one before the actors left. And this is the proudest one. I am most proud of this one. This is, her name is, she's really good. She has the energy of Marion de Contreras. She's really awesome. And then this play we decided was about a woman who wanted to bury her child because she was infected with HIV. And so, sorry, before that. Yeah, so I worked with Eric Ruffin here. It was a collaboration because they didn't have enough time. So at this point, when we were doing this series of workshops with Marco and Neil, it will be in the morning, and then in the afternoon we'll do site-specific work with Stephen. Stephen, so it was together in a week that we did this. I helped them to make it site-specific as well. So it was just going out of the exercise a bit by incorporating what we learned from the other side, the other workshop. So yeah. Alberto, very good actor. We were commended for actually having used the space really well because, So this is the, behind this is the building itself, the MaMa building. This is where we hang our clothes. The kitchen is here. And then up to the mountain on the other side. So she actually, in this production, we actually made the audience walk together with her up to the mountain, and then they assembled here to see the beautiful view of the Umbrian hills. Yeah. So it's about it. Yeah. So these are the actors. Marco, Alberto, I can't remember the name, Luca, Michael. This is Steven. He taught us site-specific work. And this is where I learned that site-specific work actually has four classifications. Site-specific, site-adaptive, site-appropriate, and what you would call Shakespeare in the Park, which doesn't really have much specificity in its staging. Site-adaptive and site-appropriate literally means if you have a play that you've written and you bring it into a space, a site, without the site itself inspiring. So for site-inspired works, for site-specific works, the idea of the play must only come when you come to the site and not before that. So you must not have any ideas beforehand. We went out of the Umbria estate itself, the MaMa Umbria estate, and went to the Spoleto open bar. So in the city of Spoleto, because of the festival, they had a bar kind of place with a stage, outdoor stage. So we went there in the day so that we could go into the city to do site-specific work. For example, this is one lady who would always be there knitting. I don't know if you can see it too clearly, but do a piece based on that. So our first assignment was to do a site-inspired work, which means we would go to a site, we would observe it, we would count how many windows, we would see human traffic, how many cars, we would see... we would basically just sit there and observe, and then go back to the rehearsal space and do something. So mine was inspired by a fountain that didn't work. It was the only fountain. So all these fountains, there was about five fountains in Spoleto, and these fountains you could actually drink from them, which was the most exciting part. And there was this one fountain which like dribbled water. So we came up with a piece about the site. Yeah. Oh, sorry, am I going too fast? Or if you have any questions, stop me. So yeah, this is site-inspired work. And then after that, we went out again and we looked at things that inspired us. This one building really inspired me because it reminded me of the Geylang Fire Station, which was a project that I did after the MaMa. So it was just placement. So I went knowing that I wanted to use that site. And then this feature just reminded me of it. And I was very curious with these two boys because they were just cycling around this compound. This was a piazza pellicola. And so I asked them whether I could take a picture of it. And then this guy said, "You want?" He didn't speak English, so he said, "Naturale or something." I can't remember. And the funny thing is, there we drink water, which is either naturale or frizzante, which means sparkling or natural. So it inspired a whole other set of things. But I reprimanded because I wasn't being inspired by the site, I was inspired by the circumstance instead. So it was very confusing. A lot of people got confused to what Stephen's direction was, because Stephen actually does more dance, site-specific work. Yeah.
Sorry,
Could
you explain a bit more about being inspired by the
circumstance? Oh, okay. Inspired by the circumstance means I'm not inspired by the site, I'm inspired by what happened in the site. So what happened was I saw these two boys cycling around and I decided to stop and have a conversation and so that thus it became a site. It was a site by a circumstance inspired. No worries. And then this was our last presentation. So you can see this is Danny, Singapore. This is Henry. Henry is from New York. And one more guy. It's not in this picture. So this became our backdrop for the last site-specific presentation. It was called Sarong. Yeah, sorry, because I was wearing a sarong. And what happened is we made use of the view. So basically in site-specific work, what you have the advantage of is you plan where the audience sits and what he or she sees. So we made them sit on the steps, and we did a bit here, far away thing, and we used this junction as our main crossroads, and then there was just Benny, who was an observer, but then he became something else after that. So that was me, and somebody pulled off my sarong and tried to open the door. So that was to indicate the piece. Before that, I actually was going to fetch water at the fountain, and then somebody grabbed it, so they just saw me without my sarong running up here and trying to get into the house. It was fun. It was fun. The first week was problematic because it was so hot. It was we had actors to play with. We went out to the town every other day. Every day actually. And this was another site-specific work where they made it like a you know those train rides where you see people inside. Like an amusement ride.
so there were like photographs of beauty. Okay. So yeah, like I was saying, the first thing was very hard for us because we had actors to work with. We went out all the time, so we weren't really cooped up. And in the second week, it was when it became a bit of identity. I want to introduce the third teaching artist, which is Miss Liz Swedos. She taught us the human being as a theatre instrument. This was my favorite, and it touched me a lot. She dealt with human sounds, like what sounds we could make, and environmental sounds, site-specific sounds, jamming, I will demonstrate later, expression of specific emotions through different sounds, breaking down a text into a musical score, and inventing a new language. So we did a lot there. So this was, she told us to find something ridiculous, write a song about it, and pick a genre. And this was, the song went, "We all have toenails and sometimes letting go." So we were just like, jammed the hell out of, so everyone else had this thing of us. But it was really fun. This is Elizabeth de Rosa. This is also Elizabeth. I can't remember her name. Henry. Yeah. That's quite fun. Yeah. This was when we had to write a monologue of an oppressor, and then in English, and after that we had to translate it into our own language, which I found really hard because I listen to foreign music. I kind of understand Mandarin. I speak Malay, and being having access to all these different languages, it was very hard to create a new language because they already have their own meaning. Yeah, so my the monologue was, "I eat rice, breadcrumbs, whatever I can find on the floor. People like to throw food at me. Maybe because they don't want to waste food. Maybe because they know how it feels to be hungry. Rice, bread, whatever I find. When I'm lucky, I get meat from an injured pigeon trying to fly away." And translated was, "Fil nakara uru lele fil wasa yo sero nami jabawi kalau guna teri teri kalau sila curup ne sila guna nakara uru lele fil yo." So it was just really breaking your habit. And then she asked us to write a song, and however we like to sing it. And because I had just done Mata Hati, I wrote a ghazal, a gay marriage ghazal, Sha'e of Sodomy. "Equality, that is all we want. We and you have two rings." Okay, sorry, I'm afraid that it's a game. "You have two rings, we only have concrete. We want to know how it feels to fight." I don't know how shy it is really. Divorce also should be our right, that is the last line. Yeah. So there was a lot of like, there's another exercise where we had to take the full text, do it in English with rhythm, translate it, and then use techniques that we have done. So I'd like to demonstrate duets. May I have two volunteers, please? Some of you guys have done this before.
Okay.
Okay, Sharon. Sharon and Nabila? Sharon and Nabila. So you just sit facing each other. Duets. You've done this before.
No.
So basically it's just making sound and just jamming with it. So like making a sound with it. So any sound whenever you're
building
the altar. So like someone will go 5 cubits so we use the sound of words to make it sound like a shovel, a saw, poles, horns, and then after that we in the gibberish we selected certain vowels and certain consonants that we wanted to use. So we decided that this text was very straightforward and very ritualistic and very uniform in its structure. So we decided to make it more flowy, and it was just us humming and going in and doing whatever we pleased. Yeah. So at the end of it, she sang for us a song, and she had not sung this song for a long time. It's called The Bird Song. We guys have heard it.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'll show you a video with her. She really inspired me. She was quite weak, but when she projected her voice, it was like you can't imagine it. She was just still so full of will. They didn't get to direct, so it was very confusing.